I want to start by sharing a photo I haven't shared in many years. So this is me in high school. My classmates called me the Mohawk Lady. I had grown up a military brat. My dad was in the Air Force, and we moved from one base to the next. So by the time I was a teenager, my main aspiration was to make sure I didn't follow any rules. It wasn't hard for me to do this. I'm the youngest of four, and by the time I was in high school, my parents were pretty checked out. More often than not, they didn't know what I was getting into and didn't know enough to be concerned. I made a lot of mistakes. For a time, it wasn't clear I would make it safely into adulthood. I share this photo because it reminds me of how I think we need to reimagine our safety and justice systems. I'll explain why in a minute. As many of you know, across the country, we're in the midst of a fundamental shift in criminal justice. Conservatives and liberals agree it's time to rethink punishment and rehabilitation. It's a big moment of opportunity and new possibilities. This is a moment I didn't think I would see in my lifetime. I remember in the 80s and 90s the explosion of the tough on crime era. Rehabilitation was deemed impossible, and politicians added more and more felonies and longer sentences to the law books. In our state, lawmakers added 1,000 crime bills, resulting in 22 new prisons and 5 times more prisoners. I remember how that changed our state's spending priorities. My friends and I saw college tuition rise and assistance programs shrink. My first job out of law school was advocating for youth in trouble. I met young people on probation in juvenile halls and facing years behind bars in the state's youth authority. Some had committed serious crimes, but many more had made mistakes I could have seen my friends and I making years ago. Virtually every young person that I met was struggling to overcome so much more than their committing offense. Eric had witnessed multiple murders before his 14th birthday. Angela had been in and out of homelessness with her family since age 5. Javier had been abused by caretakers while bouncing from one foster care placement to the next. These are young people that had rarely, if ever, experienced safety or been protected from harm. They'd been victimized, traumatized, and the signs of trouble were there so much longer before their first arrest. Many got worse after they went into the justice system, at times losing hope for themselves and their own humanity. I remember David, who was incarcerated at age 15, telling me, "At times it's easier for me to become like the concrete around me than go in that visiting room and see my mom." Later, I went from advocating for young people in trouble to going inside government and working on public safety issues in Oakland and San Francisco. I worked on everything from police recruitment to gang violence and neighborhood blight. At the time, both cities were experiencing a rash of crime and violence, record high homicide rates. I've been to more funerals and community meetings than I can recall, sitting with grieving mothers who couldn't understand why there was no front page news when their child was gunned down, visiting domestic violence shelters, homeless shelters, drug treatment programs with waiting lists far longer than they could ever accommodate. I started to see these two problems, an overrun justice system that had been stripped of rehabilitation and unsafe, distressed communities with too few resources, as two sides of the same coin. We spend billions of dollars on criminal justice, yet we can't seem to protect kids from getting assaulted on their way to school or get people in crisis into treatment and shelter. We've created a system that's profoundly unsafe. So what would a new vision for safety and justice look like? When we launched Californians for Safety and Justice 2 years ago, we decided to take a radical approach to trying to answer that question. We asked crime survivors what they thought. We went into the neighborhoods where the Erics and the Angelas and the Javiers grew up. We asked these residents, what would you need to be safe? After 2 years, we've talked to thousands of crime survivors across California. And the answers are not what you may think. More than anything, what we've heard from crime survivors is they want a different kind of safety, a safety that's rooted in health and healing, safe routes to schools, safe places to go when crisis erupts, supportive systems that don't blame them for conditions. When it comes to criminal justice, they want accountability, but much more investment in rehabilitation and breaking the cycle of crime instead of ever-increasing punishments. So we're building a movement to win this new possibility. Out of this work has come a new idea that California voters will have the opportunity to vote on this November. The Safe Neighborhoods and Schools Act will take petty crimes and change them from felonies to misdemeanors and invest the savings into schools and prevention and community treatment. It's about restoring the balance between accountability and prevention. It's a huge opportunity to reimagine criminal justice. I know that we can do this. I know that we can do this because we do it for some already. Back to that photo. Overcoming my rebellious past did not result from much of my own doing. In fact, my transgressions led to help. Police let me go home instead of taking me to juvenile hall. Teachers gave me do-overs and let me pass classes. My parents had resources for counseling and help. The response to me was one of concern for my safety and faith in my capacity to overcome challenges. This is what all kids deserve. It shouldn't be based on race and class privilege. This concern should be embedded in our approach to safety and justice for everyone, especially those cycling in and out of the justice system as crime victims and lawbreakers. The stakes are too high for us to do anything else. Our next generation depends on it. That's my little girl. My mom believes in karma. So my mom says, if karma has anything to do with it, this little girl is going to give me a run for my money when she's a teenager. Whatever happens, whatever she gets into, I want to know that she will be treated as someone who deserves safety and protection, as someone who can accomplish anything, regardless of any mohawks she may have or mistakes that she may make. Safety and protection, faith in our capacity to change. That's what all children deserve, and that's what we need to claim in our safety and justice systems. Thank you.